I have to read my speech because I'm used to sitting at home.
Somebody hold the mic.
Yeah, could you hold for me?
Yeah, sure.
I don't usually do this in public. I do it in my ratty sweater stroking my cats. I wanted to give you some answers to some of the propaganda that the CBC is putting out, because they have arguments that they have been circulating around to tell us, and these arguments are easily rebutted. The CBC has responded to these vociferous protests against the changes to Radio 2 and the cancellation of the orchestra, which are protests which are curling all around the country, and they've responded with some seriously expensive propaganda. And guess who's paying for this propaganda? We are the very people who are against it. And there is something irritating, I'm sure you'd agree, about this use of our tax money to convince us that we want something we don't want. So I would like to suggest to you all some answers to the points that the CBC's PR machine is circulating in its defense. I think one can't help but notice that there is a certain disconnect between what CBC Radio says it is doing and what it actually does. The spokesmen make very soothing noises, don't they? Of course we're not turning against classical music, they say. We are still fully committed to it. It remains at the core of the programming. And by this, they mean pretty much the opposite. They mean that it will be removed from the most popular programs at breakfast, during the drive home, and during the evening. They deny that the direction they want to take is to lighter and easier music. And yet this sentence occurs in the summary report of the CBC Arts and Research Culture Study that led to the planned reforms, and I have a copy of it here if you want to read it. I quote from the study summary, CBC staff implicitly recognizes that arts and culture programming overall should become more accessible, engaging, and lighter in tone. Tell us too that there are 35,000 Canadian songs released every year. And note that they say songs and not pieces of music. 35,000 Canadian songs released, and only 0.8% of those are played on commercial airwaves. It sounds very sad. But it doesn't address the question of whether those 35,000 songs are all of equal artistic value.
Yes.
Artistic value is not something the CBC likes to talk about. It sounds elitist. No, this is Canada. All those 35,000 songs deserve a prize. They say Radio 2 is going to be more relevant. As if the past is no longer relevant. As if the great art of the present is not relevant. They say they are going to reflect musical diversity. Again, what they mean is the opposite. They mean a wide array of contemporary singer-songwriters from Winnipeg to Brampton. What does diversity mean to you? When I think of musical diversity, I think of, say, a piece of choral music from, say, 1500, and Stravinsky's Rite of Spring. Now, that's diversity. Between those two pieces of music. They come from completely different cultures and mentalities. They're not even played on the same instruments. That is diversity. When the CBC talks about diversity, they mean Canadian singer-songwriters from the year 2008. What they mean is a terrible sameness. They tell us this is not true. We have to wait and see. Wait until September when all the changes are in place and we will find challenging and diverse music. Why don't I believe them? Well, because their track record with popular genres is not great. When the CBC targets middle age, as they are explicitly doing with their planned new station, they tend to target the middle of everything. Their tastes for the past 20 years have been slowly but inexorably moving towards the bland and easily digestible, towards light jazz, jazz pop, folk pop classics. Hey, I may be wrong, of course. You know, maybe we should wait till September to find out if I'm wrong. My gut feeling is I really, really hope you like Feist. Because, you know, come September, you're going to be hearing an awful lot of her. Yeah, I may be wrong.
Oh, what's your first name?
I don't even know her first name.
But if we wait, If we wait till September and we are wrong, the core of this great institution, one full of musical experts and expertise, one that's taken 50 years or more to build up, will have been dismantled. It will be too late. They claim over and over again, there's no attack on classical music. But they're coincidentally eliminating the radio orchestra we've had for 70 years. They have coincidentally... Incidentally, cut the CBC Young Composers competition and the CBC Young Performers competition. They have coincidentally cut the classical music budget of CBC Records. And all this, they say, this has nothing to do with the reduction of music on the radio, nothing at all, total coincidence. Well, what is that phrase about actions and words? I just want to close by describing a couple of the several hundred heartfelt personal stories I've received by lovers of music over the past few weeks. People are sending me letters and emails describing their own first encounters or life-changing experiences with art music, and it all came to them via the radio. These letters are for people in rural areas who do not have access to commercial classical music stations. Stores or symphony orchestras or chamber groups or any schools that teach music appreciation. And some of them, in fact, don't even have high-speed internet. So much for all the news streaming on the internet. They're writing to me about how their first symphony or their first opera heard on the radio exposed them to a world of thought and beauty that they would never have had access to otherwise. This is the opposite of elitism. This is democracy. Here's a story. I'm going to read you one story from a reader who wrote to me, Neil Stewart, who was a Canadian soldier in Holland in March of 1945. And he tells this story of his first encounter with classical music on the radio, on public radio. His tank regiment was the Canadian Grenadier Guards, and they were recovering from fierce fighting in Germany, and they were in the town of Tilburg in the Netherlands. The tanks were lined up on the street for repair, and out of the houses came a stream of excited residents. And the residents were shouting, "Gigli! Gigli!" And they invited the Canadians inside to listen to the first broadcast they were hearing from the newly liberated Radio Eindhoven, which had been under Nazi occupation. And they were listening to the voice of Beniamino Gigli. And he said that the tears were running down the cheeks of the Dutch host to be able to hear the music of their own choice on their own radio station. And the hardened Canadian tank man, and Mr. Stewart writes, they sat in rapt silence as the golden voices filled the rooms in the humble homes where they sat. And Mr. Stewart writes, all of the people referred to in this memory of World War II were ordinary people at the type and social level that some would consider quite beyond the appeal of classical music. Yet given exposure to it, however fleetingly or unlikely, they treated it with the deepest of respect and admiration. Why should we deprive them of it? Thank you.